Jiminy Crickets.
Jiminy Cricket is the name. I'm a happy-go-lucky fellow, always getting it wrong for singing my song. A merry old soul am I. Jiminy Cricket is the name. I'll be hanging around this evening. I'll be tipping my hat and telling you that Jiminy Cricket is the name.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to episode number 118 of the Jiminy Crickets podcast. How are you doing, Ruthie?
I'm doing great, Chris. How are you?
I'm doing out of this world. Because this week we're going to talk about one of everybody's favorite Disney park attractions, Space Mountain, which just a few days ago on January 15th, 2020, celebrated its 45th anniversary. It opened in 1975 at Walt Disney World, so we thought it was a perfect time to talk about a favorite Disneyland e-ticket adventure. But before we get to that, we have a very special announcement. The Jiminy Crickets podcast proudly endorses Concierge Vacation Planners, a Disney-authorized specialty vacation planning service. Concierge doesn't just book your trip, they walk you through the entire process, helping you plan out every detail, one-on-one, to make the very most out of your vacation while saving you both time and money. And the best part is, they charge nothing for their services. You will get the exact same pricing as if you booked your vacation directly through Disney. But in using Concierge expertise, you've got the added bonus of having your very own personal Disney guru planner by your side. Both Ruthie and I are also satisfied customers, and we just can't recommend them enough. Visit their website at www.concierge.com. That's www.concierge.com, as in mouse ears. So when you book your next Disney vacation, be it Walt Disney World, Disneyland, the Disney Cruise Line, or many of the other Disney destinations available worldwide, contact Concierge Vacation Planners, and be sure to tell them Disney Chris sent you.
Earthman has long dreamed of exploring the mysteries of our galaxy and the infinite wonders of the universe beyond. You will experience these wonders on your own space journey when Disneyland's spectacular super thrill attraction, Space Mountain, opens in June 1977. Space Mountain, towering 120 feet into the sky, will complete Walt Disney's original dreams and visions for Tomorrowland. Within this futuristic structure, you will be the astronaut hurling through super space in a high-speed race into another galaxy.
Launch control. This is Space Venture. Go ahead.
You and your fellow astronauts board rocket cars on the space station launching platform, orbiting high above the Earth. As your journey begins, you'll race through a vast man-made solar field, energizing your rocket car for its dazzling plunge into super space. Hold on tight. You're on your way as you blast off into the void of the universe. Swooping around the giant glowing geodesic laser satellite, you become engulfed by a spectacular spiral nebula with flashing comets and whirling galaxies. This is super space penetration. At Walt Disney World in Florida, guests are already experiencing the sensations of a Space Mountain adventure. You will share these sensations when Space Mountain opens at Disneyland. Ascending the launch portal, aimed at a starry vista of the cosmos overhead, blasting off on a breathtaking, super-fast race through outer space, your body actually feeling the forces of G. Zooming down the re-entry portal, feeling the blast of hot air and rocked by a sonic boom. Yes, you will experience what is truly the ultimate thrill ride attraction. So climb aboard, fasten your seatbelt, and prepare to blast off when Space Mountain opens in June 1977 in Tomorrowland.
Space Mountain was an idea that goes all the way back to the 1960s when Walt Disney was discussing adding a second thrill ride to Disneyland upon the success of the Matterhorn. And he enlisted John Hench, a Disney legendary Imagineer, to come up with an idea for a Tomorrowland-themed roller coaster. But it goes back even further than that, because it really starts with Walt Disney's fascination with space travel, which began in the mid-1950s when he was planning and developing Disneyland, and he started to recruit space experts to be involved in his television series, which was also called Disneyland, like Wernher von Braun and other German scientists who were essential and crucial to developing the NASA space program, which hadn't even been developed yet when Walt Disney was first showcasing it on his television series. And of course, all of this collaboration led up to the different space travel adventures that people would find in the original 1950s and early 1960s version of Tomorrowland, which included, of course, the rocket to the moon, but it also included the Satellite View of America attraction, otherwise known as Space Station X-1, and the rocket jets, originally known as the Astro Jets, which would have sort of a big impact on Space Mountain just because of the design of the vehicles were very similar to what eventually would become Space Mountain. Sort of the whole concept behind the Astro Jets was sort of what led up to Space Mountain. And of course, the unidentified flying saucer attraction. So Walt Disney originally thought of Tomorrowland as sort of a science fact zone, but he sort of let loose on the reins over time, especially with the unidentified flying saucers. So I really feel like that was where his philosophy about what Tomorrowland could be really changed, was with that attraction. And that was definitely an influence on Space Mountain, because Space Mountain is mostly science fiction and not science fact. Even though it's based on what we think of as the future, space travel, back then and even now. But I feel like that attraction and the Astro Jets, people don't think about it as being influential on Space Mountain, but I think they really were, because of just their overall look. You know, it was more of a fun future and less of a factual future, which is sort of what Space Mountain led up to. So, aside from, you know, his early thinkings and early attractions that had to do with space travel, right around when the 1964 World's Fair was pretty much all of the development was completed and all the shows were playing at the fair, Walt Disney looked at his Tomorrowland and really felt that with all the amazing things happening at the World's Fair, they could really do something a lot more impressive with Tomorrowland. So they came up with a whole layout for the new land, which is very similar to what we saw in 1967. And they left a space for a very crucial e-ticket attraction that was part of the master plan for the original New Tomorrowland of 1967. And that was a space that was left for what was then being called Spaceport. And Spaceport is really what Space Mountain became, but if you look at some of the early concept drawings, you can see similarities, but what would you say it looks anything like what it actually became? First of all, it was pink in most of the drawings. And the rockets went in and outside of the building. Just sort of like the Matterhorn, where it wove in and out of the mountain structure. So they were really thinking of this as sort of a Matterhorn type experience originally, but instead of having two tracks, they actually were planning on having four tracks for more capacity. And the cone-like structure was originally designed by John Hench, and there are definitely similarities between what it was back then and what it eventually became. But by the time it opened in Florida in 75, it became a lot more streamlined looking, more less is more, you know, less clutter, a lot more simple design, which I actually, believe it or not, I much prefer over the original. How do you feel, Ruthie?
Do you like the original John Hench design or what it actually became?
Well, I really see, you know, John Hench's original design is really futuristic and amazing, considering that, like, the time when he drew it in, like, 1964, 65, and that he just was able to just pull that out of his brain. It's just amazing. I don't really think it looks that much different, other than the fact that, yeah, he did design the attraction to go outside of the building then come back in. But I think, you know, the final structure that we all see and know and love now, I think it really is quite close to his drawing. And I think it's just awesome. I love the look of the building. I think it is timeless. Like, I don't care when, you know, 1975, 1977, when these attractions were built, that means nothing to me when you look at this building. I think that it still represents...
It holds up.
Yeah, like today, because we don't have a lot of buildings that look like that, even today in 2020, you know, so I still think it's just a timeless design. And, I mean, it just goes to show you the minds of these Imagineers and how forward-thinking they were. So I just feel like it really represents what Walt Disney was thinking back then, too. You know, back when he was designing the park and talking about it on TV in 1954.
So the differences I see are that the original John Hench design was a lot more of a cone structure. Like, it went... It tapered off, and it was more of like a more triangular, more pyramid-like. And then the eventual version was more squashed and more flying saucer-looking. It wasn't. It didn't come to a peak. It sort of had a flat top. I mean, but there are. Don't get me wrong. There are very close similarities between the two, but there are differences. And I think it's the final version is just a little bit more, less frou-frou, a little bit less detail and a little more simple, but in a good way. I think if they had gone with the original design, it would have held up also, but it would have been more science fiction-y. And to me, the version that they have now just looks a little, just more like a futuristic structure of some kind. I don't know.
Yeah.
Anyway, it's a recognizable landmark in every park, and it's even people who haven't been to Disney and know very little about Disney recognize that building and know what it is. The project, unfortunately, went on hold. They were sort of, you know, not really there technology-wise in the 60s. But they were just sort of hoping, like with the Matterhorn, they just decided to build it and to figure out the technology as they went. That's how the Matterhorn happened. They didn't know what the heck they were going to do until they just tried to do it and figured it out. But and that was all Bob Gurr's doing. But what happened was, without Walt Disney there, because he passed away when it was still in development, without Walt Disney there to sort of just push it forward and, you know, they sort of chickened out, basically, and decided to open the new Tomorrowland without Space Mountain, which was still being called Spaceport at that point. But they left a space for it. They didn't change the layout of the land, and the space they had originally planned to put it was still there. But instead of putting Space Mountain there, they put an outdoor theater which they call the Tomorrowland Stage, which was actually designed by Raleigh Crump. So they had this outdoor stage sort of in that little corner where they had originally planned to put Space Mountain. So jumping forward to Florida, that was another reason why it didn't get built, was because of all the energies being turned towards Florida. And what happened was, because the castle was so large in Florida, they decided not to include the Matterhorn, because the Matterhorn would have looked ridiculous next to this giant castle. It would have looked like the wrong size. So they decided not to include the Matterhorn in Florida. And that sort of created a problem, because there were no thrill rides in the Florida park at all. And there was a demand for it. So Disney sort of had to come up with a different idea for a thrill attraction. And at the same time, sort of parallel things are happening. So I'm sort of going back and forth here for a second. At the same time, Disney had a sponsorship deal with RCA. See, RCA had designed all of the telephone systems throughout the new Walt Disney World. They sponsored it, designed it, and they were given an option to also sponsor an attraction. And Disney, after the Florida park had opened, went back and started to design an attraction that they felt would be suitable for an RCA sponsorship. And they designed an attraction based on computers. And the RCA executives hated it. So they went back to the drawing boards and decided to kill two birds with one stone, because they needed to put in a thrill attraction. And they could put it in Tomorrowland, and it would be appropriate for RCA because they were a future-forward company. They like to be affiliated with the future. So they decided to go back to the drawing board and take the Space Mountain concept off the shelf and revisit it. And by now, it was the early 70s, around 1972, the technology had quickly caught up, and they were, some of the things that weren't available in the mid-60s by now had been developed. So originally they were going to have four individual tracks like in the original plan, but because of new technology that had emerged, they were able to run more cars on the track at a single time. So they were able to make it only two tracks and make it a longer attraction and have more multiple sleds running on one track at a time because of the computer technology that was now available to do that safely. I mean, the Matterhorn could run more than one at a time, but not as many as Space Mountain could run. Mm-hmm. So that was when the whole plan went forward, and RCA was excited about it, and they came on as the official sponsor, and they began construction in late 1972, I believe, and the original opening date was publicized as 1974, but it got pushed back a little bit and opened in early 1975. But the whole planning of the new Space Mountain sort of led to a whole redo, basically, of Tomorrowland in Florida, because the original Tomorrowland in Florida was pretty pitiful, basically. There were like three attractions, well, maybe four if you count the Skyway. But the only things that were there at the time they started building Space Mountain was the Mission to Mars, America the Beautiful Circle Vision, the Grand Prix Raceway, and the Skyway. That was it. Mm-hmm. So when they added Space Mountain, they not only added Space Mountain, but they added the People Mover, they added the rocket jets, And they added the Carousel of Progress. And during the whole thing, they also added another attraction exclusive to Florida, which was If You Had Wings, which opened 1 year before Space Mountain. So basically, they didn't really finish Tomorrowland until they brought in Space Mountain. And then it really felt like a full, complete land when they added all of that. And it all opened together in 1975.
That's kind of funny, because if you think about it, Disneyland opened in 55 and didn't really complete its Tomorrowland until 59. And the same thing with Florida.
Yeah, 4 years later.
Yeah.
When they had the grand opening ceremony, they invited a bunch of real astronauts to preside over the ceremony. And they had a huge band, and all of the marching band all stood on the platforms for the People Mover and encircled Space Mountain and played music. And then they released thousands of red, white, and blue balloons, which they don't do that anymore because it's not good for the... it's a terrible thing to do to the environment.
Right.
But they didn't think that way back then. And then they shot off... again, we talked about this in the last episode we did for Disneyland 59. They shot off daytime fireworks, which is a concept I do not quite understand. But
right.
But they did color them so that you could see the puffs of smoke in red, white, and blue. I think it would have been more effective if they had had the ceremony at night, which there's no reason why they couldn't have, but whatever.
Event is starting, the official dedication of Space Mountain in Tomorrowland. You're going to see thousands of flying doves, a pageant of nations with a 2,000 member band. Can you stand it? Later there'll be 50,000 balloons and fireworks like you've never seen before, red, white, and blue. And we're finally going to get our chance to ride Space Mountain. Now look up on the stage. There's a man who piloted America's second orbital flight, the pilot of Mercury 7, Scott Carpenter. And next to him, a gentleman who flew 142 flights around the Earth on two missions, veteran of Mercury 9 and Gemini 5, Gordon Cooper. And also seated next to him is Jim Irwin, a man who not only found galaxies in space, but a special feeling of man's relationship to God, the pilot of the lunar module of Apollo 15, and founder of the Spiritual High Flight Foundation. Colonel Jim Irwin is about to speak.
This great achievement for science and technology was possible because of dedicated men who had the vision for the future. We astronauts are here today to salute all those who made our trip into space possible. They have permitted us to see the Earth as a precious blue jewel in the blackness of space. Now all of us may enjoy this sense of wonder because of Walt Disney. Walt had a dream. Today we see the results of that dream.
Archivals, we proudly present Space Mountain.
It was a big spectacle, and Space Mountain was an immediate hit, and it was really three attractions in one, because you got both sides, which are slightly different, plus there was a post show, which was pretty amazing, which was sponsored by RCA, called the Home of Future Living, sort of an updated version of the House of the Future from the original Tomorrowland in California, but you rode by on a moving ramp all these different scenes that showed what home life would be like in the future. Mm-hmm. And interestingly, a lot of the things that they showed actually happened. Like they showed a laptop computer, believe it or not, widescreen, flat screen TVs, internet communications, even though they didn't call it that, it was basically what they were projecting. So it was actually pretty incredible how close to, you know, the future they were projecting, how close it actually came to what they thought it would be. Mm-hmm. The only thing they weren't quite right on was the fashions and the home decor. That was pretty far off. Because you have to think, you know, this was the 70s, so it was a 70s thought process of how the future would look, which is not really how it happened. Thank God. Oranges and earth tones and olive green, not my favorite thought for home design. I mean, that was what it really was in the 70s. We had the goldenrod refrigerator and our next door neighbors had, you know, you either had the goldenrod or the ugly brown, or you had
the green avocado
green. Like those were your three color options for your kitchen appliances. And they all matched. It was all matchy matchy. Like we had the gold. We had the gold stove, the gold oven, the gold refrigerator, the gold sink. Everything was gold. I think out of the three colors, that was probably the better choice.
Right, right.
But it still was kind of ugly. Anyway, we're going on a tangent here. So that was the Disney World Space Mountain.
Here's to the future. Here's to the future. Here's to the future. Here's to the future and you. To a world full of colors, a perfect harmony. A world full of music, a living melody. The dreams of tomorrow are beginning today. It's a world of discovery that once seemed far away. There's knowledge and vision from spaceships in flight. Invention and sound, achievements in sight. So here's to the future that's coming into view. It's a world of living color and pleasure just for you. Let your dreams lead the way, lead the way.
Here's to the future. Here's to music, a living melody. The dreams of tomorrow are beginning today. It's a world of discovery that once seemed far away. There's knowledge and vision from spaceships and flight. Dimension in sound, achievements in sight. So here's to the future that's coming into view. It's a world of living color and pleasure just for you.
Because it was such a huge hit, it took only a few weeks or maybe a month or so before they were like, we got to go back and put this in Disneyland too. So they decided to put it where they had originally planned on putting it, in that place where the Tomorrowland Theater existed. Mm-hmm. And they came up with a whole neat idea of creating a whole special complex for this whole thing, sort of like a mall in a way. And they called it the Space Mountain Concourse. So this was going to include, of course, Space Mountain, which was a scaled-down version of the Florida design with only one track because they didn't have the space to put two tracks. But technology had rolled along, and by now they had reached a point where they even could increase the capacity in Tomorrowland in California from the Florida, which had two tracks, because now with the technology, they could run even more rockets on the track at a time. So the capacity was actually higher in California, even though it only had one track, than it was in Florida, believe it or not. So the complex, the concourse, included the attraction. Plus, they decided to keep the theater, but incorporate it into the architecture of that new complex. And so there was a theater there. Now they called it the Space Stage. And it was pretty amazing because as a backdrop to the stage was Space Mountain up above you. Mm-hmm. So it was gorgeous. And then they had a restaurant, a fast food restaurant, called the Space Place. And then, of course, they had the Starcade. And they had a restroom area. It was a whole complex with palm trees. And it looked like a futuristic shopping mall in a way. Mm-hmm. And it's all, that whole structure is still there, but it's just been completely ruined by changes and different theming everywhere and nothing matches. But when it opened in the 70s, it was wonderful. It was cohesive. It was beautiful. It was just so futuristic. The stage. So the stage is still there, but what is it now, Ruthie? Explain what happened to that stage.
Well, a little bit after they had it, they designed this whole complex, they decided to enclose it because it was open.
It was an amphitheater.
Yeah. So they decided to enclose it and make it kind of like a sit-in theater, which is they kind of did this around the early 80s, and they were playing some 3D movies in there and stuff like that. So that's kind of what happened, and it became the Magic Eye Theater, where they played Magic Journeys and then Captain EO and then Honey, I Shrunk the Audience.
Right. So Kodak sponsored that, and they originally, like you just said, played the Epcot Center film Magic Journeys there. Actually, what's interesting is originally they started playing it there in the open air theater.
Mm-hmm, right.
And while it was playing, then they added the ceiling because they were planning on bringing in Captain EO while Magic Journeys was still playing there. So they put the ceiling. Then they continued to play Magic Journeys until Captain EO was ready to replace it. Yeah, so that's what happened to that. And it's the theater's still there, but now it's covered and it's not as, I don't know. I wish they would they'd take the roof off again and make that an amphitheater again, because it was, they're not doing anything with that space anymore. It's not useful anymore. They're not playing a 3D attraction there or anything. And I think what they should do is they should get rid of the theater in Fantasyland and use that space for something else that's Fantasyland themed.
Right.
And then, so they still have a theater in Disneyland. They should take the roof off and refurbish it to be the space stage again. That's what I would do. But who am I? So anyway, the Starcade was interesting because this was before they really had the, you know, before the 80s. I mean, I think the most sophisticated thing they had there in 77 was Pong.
Right.
I mean, they didn't have a lot of pinball and air hockey. Mm-hmm. I still remember going in there and hearing that air hockey noise, that clicking sound.
Yep.
And it was really cool because they had sort of like a sports theme on the walls. It was very like 70s, a lot of oranges and brown. This is where I think it's kind of a gray area because that orange and brown theme can work or it can be really awful. I think in this case, I thought it looked really cool. The way they had murals all around that looked like racing cars and planes and all sorts of like... looked a lot like movement. Remember those in high school? Remember those gold folders that had all the sports on them?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's sort of that look to it.
Yeah. I know what you're talking about.
Yeah. Anybody, you know, younger than us has no idea what I just said. But if you're our age, you know exactly what I'm talking about. I don't think they make those anymore, and they haven't for years. But anyway, and then the space place was a huge, sort of like the Tomorrowland Terrace. They had two Tomorrowland Terraces, basically. But this was all within the Space Mountain complex. And there were balconies and overhangs and everything. And you could actually watch the stage productions while you were eating. Now, where the space stage... Where the space place used to be is now where the entrance to Space Mountain is. When you walk up that sort of incline and you see that big panel straight in front of you, you know what I'm talking about? That used to be the menu board for the space place. Nobody knows that but me, but do you remember that?
And
right under it were the walk-up windows where you placed your order. So... Just giving you a little bit of fun facts here, folks, on what used to be.
But you can still see it there. I mean, it's not, obviously, the windows are not there, but...
The general layout of everything is still there, but they've taken things out and put roofs on things. But what about the attraction itself? So the difference between Disneyland and Disney World is that... In Disney World, you have to go down this huge corridor because you're actually going underneath the train tracks. Mm-hmm. So you go down this, like, huge, long corridor, and then the loading area is sort of small, and it's not quite... In Disneyland, you actually... Originally, you went up an escalator, and you enter the building from the second floor, and, the building actually goes underground for part of it so they could fit more tracks. So part of the track goes underground, actually, when you get towards the end, when you're spinning around to the exit area. But you actually would go up, and then you would... The queue area was sort of on the second floor, and then you would pass by, you know, it looked like hallways and different corridors that looked like the future. And then you would enter a huge loading area with a hanging spacecraft in there, and you went down a ramp back down to the ground floor. You get on your spacecraft, and then you would go up a huge... when your attraction started, you go up, and it's exactly the same now as it was then. You go up several ramps. You go up a hill, and then you turn around and go up another hill. I think you go up two large ones and one little tiny one at the end as your little final little lift. But I feel like what was more exciting about the Disneyland one was the anticipation of going up all those hills, because you sort of know what's coming. In Florida, there's just one hill.
Yeah.
And it's sort of open, and you're in a big room where you see sort of a spaceship and a mission control tower, and it's a big room where you're going up the hill, and the People Mover actually goes through it. But in California, it's sort of a confined space where you go up the lift hills. And when you get to that last little hill, and you're just at the top, and it seems, I like that layout better. It just seems more...
Yeah.
It just gets you pumped more. It gets you more excited about...
Yeah, it is
a little
bit more mysterious.
Yeah. But one thing that's kind of fun about the Florida version is that when you first get on the rocket, you kind of go through this corridor, and it looks like you're going to crash into a mirror, and you hear sort of... And it goes... And then you make the corner, and then you start going up the lift hill. They don't have that in California. The Disneyland version, I also feel, is more thrilling. Like, the Disney World version is not as fast, and it doesn't seem as many sharp turns and hill. Like, the Disneyland version just seems a little more intense to me. I don't know if I'm correct about that, but I've been on both many times, and I always felt the Disneyland version is more intense. How do you feel?
It's okay, so it's hard to say. I've definitely been on the Disneyland one a lot of times, so much so that I pretty much memorized the track.
Yeah.
So I know when, you know, you're going to tip to the left, tip to the right, you know, things like that. You're going to drop down. But the Florida one, I don't know it as well as that. So to me, when I do go on it in Florida, it seems a little bit more exciting. And I think it's because of that, because I don't
know the track
as well. Right.
Yeah. So, I mean, believe it or not, when I was a kid, I did not do roller coasters at all. And I didn't even go on Space Mountain till I was in my 20s. So I had actually went on the Florida version first, because I worked in Florida, and that was when I first went on it, because my friends sort of forced me to go on it. And I'm glad they did, because I realized it wasn't as bad as I thought it was, and I actually grew to love it and enjoy it. So after having done that, I actually, a few years later, moved to California for a while and got an annual pass to Disneyland, and that's when I first experienced Space Mountain, even though I had... gone there and I worked there, and I had never been on. I think I went on it once when I was really tiny, like probably 8 years old, with my mom and dad, and my mother's even more horrified with roller coasters than I was, because I have these visuals in my head of my mom in the dark on a roller coaster screaming her head off and yelling at my dad, David, I'm gonna kill you! Like, I just have that in my head. And I'm pretty sure that was Space Mountain. So, I mean, when I was really little, I didn't hate. It wasn't until, like, my mother's fears sort of got into me, like, she sort of freaked me out, that I sort of started not liking roller coasters for a while. But I grew out of that. So, I always found the one in California more, but maybe it's the opposite, because I knew the one in Florida, and then when I went on the one in California, I didn't know what to expect. So it could be that in the opposite direction for me. Who knows?
Yeah.
So anyway, everything pretty much stayed the same for several years. Oh, I should mention something about the cultural world of 1977. Space Mountain couldn't have opened at a more perfect time culturally because of the whole Star Wars craze that was going on. And Disney didn't even know it, but they cashed in on that big time, because this tied into that perfectly. It opened right at the same time that Star Wars opened. Yep. And it led to huge attendance for Disneyland. And it was an amazing time to go to the park, because it was just so culturally relevant at that time to just an amazing degree. And that was complete happenstance. It was not planned that way. It just sort of worked out that way.
And I do know in 1977, when Space Mountain opened at Disneyland, it had one of the longest lines, and it went all the way back to the flagpole in Town Square.
True, and I think even at times went outside the tunnels. under the train station. It was huge. It was a huge success. And the other thing that it allowed was for them to actually, now that they had another thrill ride, they had the ability to close down the Matterhorn for a little while and give that a little TLC and add some fun elements to that. Like Harold, Abominable Snowman, and they added the second bobsled, the tandem bobsleds, which was an exact clone of what they had done in Florida, because their Space Mountain had the same vehicles as the Matterhorn, but it had two vehicles attached together, so they decided to do that for the Matterhorn. Now, the vehicles in Space Mountain in California are different, because they're side by side.
Yeah.
But the ones in the Matterhorn and in Space Mountain in Florida are, you sit in one in a row, like a row of one person. So anyway, the success of Space Mountain was a no-brainer that when Tokyo Disneyland opened in 1983, that they built a exact clone of the Disneyland version for the new overseas park, and it opened with the park on opening day in April of 1983. So the next Space Mountain came in the mid-90s. They had originally planned on building a Space Mountain as part of the opening day plans for Disneyland Paris, then known as Euro Disneyland. But they had some budget issues, so they actually decided to include Space Mountain as Phase 2. And then after the park opened, it was questionable whether there was ever going to be a Phase 2, because it was sort of a flop in the beginning. It was a financial disaster for Disney in the early years. But they actually got an investor after a couple years, and with the extra bit of money that they had to revitalize and hopefully save the park, they decided that they could add the Space Mountain, and maybe that would help with attendance. And jumping forward a little bit, it absolutely did. It saved the park by opening a Space Mountain there, which if they had done that in the beginning, maybe they would have had a problem. But the difference, there are huge differences between the Space Mountain in Disneyland Paris and the first three Space Mountains. First of all, the theming is completely different, because it was all set to the Discovery Land theme, which is not necessarily the same as Tomorrowland. What it is it's all based on the past looking to the future. So it was sort of a steampunk version, a retro future, and all based on Jules Verne and H.G. Wells and all those sci-fi writers from the early, late, you know, the 1800s and early 20th century. So they decided to base their Space Mountain on the Jules Verne novel, From the Earth to the Moon. And so instead of having the launch situation that they did in California, they built a giant cannon on the outside of the building, and you were actually shot into space on what looked like a giant cannon. And so that was visible from outside the building. And then the rest of the attraction was all inside. And another really interesting difference is there's a lot of practical three-dimensional set pieces inside the version in Paris. Like they have rolling craters and planets and things all around you that are not projections. They're really in the room with you. So that adds an element as well. And another major difference is the vehicle was more of a traditional roller coaster, because it had a whole train of cars. So it was more like Big Thunder Mountain type train than just having two rockets combined. So it was a whole train of vehicles. So What happened was they also designed this attraction to have a musical score on the rockets that you could hear while you were going through the attraction. They actually designed a musical score to sync with the twists and turns of the attraction so that when you made a big dip, the music would do a big sort of dip sound for you musically. And it all really added to the drama of this attraction. And it was such a huge success that they decided to do another soundtrack for the California version of Space Mountain. And they actually redesigned the vehicles to have onboard speakers, and they wrote a whole musical score to correspond with the existing track of the California Space Mountain. And that's the version I went on when I first started going on Space Mountain. And they were also going to do that in Florida. And they had big plans to redo the Space Mountain in Florida, but then it never ended up happening. And later they sort of added some off-vehicle music into the Florida attraction, but it's not as effective. And I really, when I've been on it, I couldn't even hear it, really. It was too noisy in there to hear it when the speaker is aren't right next to your ears like they are in California. So they just sort of, what happened, you know, after Euro Disney in the late 90s sort of became a budget cut situation for Disney. So even though they had plans to add all that to Florida, it never ended up happening. So cut to a few years later, and they started doing all these fun overlays to the different versions of Space Mountain. And I think the first version that they ever did, Ruthie, you experienced this. It was the Rockin' Space Mountain in California. Tell us what that was all about.
Well, I remember this was kind of like a promotion that they did, which, so Disneyland's, I guess, slower times is the beginning of the year. So like January to April. And so they did this promotion at both parks, at Disneyland and at California Adventure, where they kind of rocked up the, or like jazzed it up a little bit, like the Space Mountain at Disneyland and then California Screamin' at the time at Disney's California Adventure. So they added actual rock songs to both of these attractions that you would hear while you were on it. So for Space Mountain, they played the song Higher Ground, which is originally a Stevie Wonder song, but it was the Red Hot Chili Peppers version of that song that they played. So that's what you would be listening to while you were riding Space Mountain.
Welcome aboard, Rocket Rockers. This is your Uncle Joe Benson, broad blasting live across the universe.
Energizing rocket receptors. Powering up.
Looks like we've been cleared for blastoff, and it sounds like the Red Hot Chili Peppers are on the space stage.
Let's have those drums. Let's hear some of that bass. We're looking and sounding good. Awesome! This is going to be out of this world. Sound systems are go.
No matter which planet you're from, we're about to rock your world. And it's all gonna happen in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and roll!
And so that was actually very easy to turn around, because all they did was they changed the lighting and they played different music in the speakers. So they could switch that on and off pretty within a 24-hour period. And, you know, it took time to design it all, but they could turn it off and do the regular... Once it was installed, they could, you know, have... One day do regular Space Mountain, and the next day do, you know, it was that easy to, it, very, very little turnaround on those overlays. They decided a few years later to try one for Halloween, and it was called Ghost Galaxy, and instead of having rock music, they played sort of creepy space, like a horror movie, like alien kind of music, and they had this demon sort of projection everywhere and scary lighting and loud noises and things to sort of for a Halloween time version. And they've had that Ghost Galaxy going on for years now. It comes back every Halloween.
I think they didn't do it this past Halloween for some reason.
I think they didn't do it because they were running, they were trying to promote, well, they had just opened the Star Wars land, and they wanted to sort of promote that. And they had a, which was the next thing we're going to talk about, is that a few years after that, they added the Hyperspace Mountain, which is a Star Wars themed version of Space Mountain. And have you seen that one, Ruthie, in person?
Yes, I actually was able to ride it at my trip this past summer in August. So I rode it once.
Yeah, and how was that?
I liked it. I mean, it was, you know, obviously the track is not changing in any of these overlays. So what they're doing is changing the projection, they're changing the music, and they're changing, you know, the things that you can see. Now, the one thing that I kind of felt was it was a little bit hard to see because some of the effects and stuff that they added for the actual Hyperspace Mountain, at least in Disneyland, you know, you're going through the track, so it's harder to see these things because you're actually, you know, experiencing the attraction, the track is surrounding you instead of practical effects and things like that.
Yeah. Because they've got all the track scaffolding and everything all around you.
Right.
This is Blue Leader. All wings report in.
Blue 6 standing by.
Blue 2 standing by.
Blue 4 here.
Blue 5 standing by.
Blue 3 standing by.
Blue 7 standing by.
Good luck, pilots.
All wings prepare to jump into hyperspace on my mark. Punch it! What was that?
They're coming out of nowhere!
Enemy fighters coming your way!
All wings, fall back.
Three marks coming in at .04.
Keep the trap!
Hold tight, I'm going in.
Watch your back, Blue 4. There's one on my tail.
Copy that, Blue 5.
I'm in!
Blue 7, you okay?
So they actually, after they did the one in California, they decided to take it one step further, and they actually added a Hyperspace Mountain, which is more permanent to the version in Paris. But before they did that, a few years prior, they had redone the original, and they called it Mission 2. So it was Space Mountain Mission 2, and it was sort of the same basic theme as the first, but they sort of updated it and made it less about a steampunk flight to the moon type situation and more of a futuristic. They sort of broke away from the constraints of what the Discovery Land theme was and did their own thing for Space Mountain. And that was really successful. And then a few years after that, they added the Hyperspace, which is now playing in Paris, very popular. People love it, but it's more of a permanent situation because, like I said, unlike the one in California, they have a lot of effects that are in the room with you. So they can change those around so that it's not like the situation in California where you're just seeing screens and things. In the Paris version, you're seeing practical set pieces around you that are themed towards the Star Wars. So those are a little harder to change out. So when they put the overlays in Paris, they're a little longer in length as far as how long they're going to stay. Currently, I believe they're still showing Hyperspace Mountain in California, but they're going to be returning to the original version very soon. If they haven't already, I'm not sure exactly. But the final version of Space Mountain to open was in Hong Kong Disneyland in 2005. It opened with the park on opening day. And again, it's very close to the Disneyland version. But they sort of built it at the same time that they were adding in a new soundtrack to the version in California, because in 2003, the California version of Space Mountain shut down for 2 years, and they completely rebuilt the entire track from the ground up. It's an exact duplicate of the original track, but they built it brand new. They demolished the original, and so, consequently, the new track is very smooth, and it's almost like gliding on air compared to the original, from what I've heard, because I haven't ridden on it. What, do you notice a difference, Ruthie?
Oh, yeah. I think it's very comfortable. Like, yeah. I mean, it's still a roller coaster, but still, you know. And it is exactly the same.
Yeah. So, when they did that, they replaced the original music with new music. So, they have a new musical score, which also goes along with the dips and turns for the attraction. And they incorporated that because it was being designed at the same time as the Hong Kong version. So that all became part of the Hong Kong Disneyland version of Space Mountain as well.
Thank you.
that song is composed by Michael Giacchino, who's a huge composer of, you know, music for Disney films.
And speaking of music, we would be remiss if we don't mention the very popular and beloved music that one hears today at the Walt Disney World version of Space Mountain, which was added when RCA renewed their sponsorship in 1985. The name of the song that you hear in Space Mountain is called We've Come So Far, and today you only hear it in the beginning cue area as an instrumental piece, but originally there was a version with lyrics and vocals that you would hear as you went through the exit area and saw the post show, which was updated for 1985 audiences and called Rika Dream of a New World. So let's listen to that beloved music from Walt Disney World.
there's so very far to go.
That is our look at Space Mountain. Do you have any final things you'd like to share about your experiences with Space Mountain, Ruthie?
So I kind of like you. I didn't ride this when I was a kid. I didn't really like roller coasters either. But really, really Disneyland is the reason why I started even riding roller coasters. And it started with, really, I think, I used to be so afraid of going on Pirates because of the hills, because that's really the thing that I don't like. But then I went on Pirates and, you know, I got up a little bit more courage and I went on Thunder Mountain and then I went on Space Mountain. And one of the things that is so intimidating about Space Mountain is that it's all indoors and you can't see the track and you don't know what's going to happen. So it, for me, I think it took a little bit more courage to get on that ride. But so I was a late teens. And I went on it and, you know, discovered that it doesn't have, you know, it does have some hills, but you don't really know when they're coming because you can't see. And it doesn't feel as, it doesn't take your stomach on that, you know, big drop like some other attractions do that do have big hills. So I found out that I loved it. And every time I go to any Disney park that has this attraction, I have to go on it because it's just not, it's not an experience at a Disney park without going on this attraction. And I do feel like, it, you know, it's really a good complement to some of the more family-friendly rides because it does give you like a little bit of a thrill and, you know, just kind of makes it a more well-rounded park to me to have this attraction there. And especially in Florida because they don't have, I mean, they just have like the Thunder Mountain and they have Splash Mountain, but they don't have the Matterhorn bobsled. So, you know, for them, they really needed to have this attraction there. And, you know, I'm really glad that they were able to, you know, take John Hench's original design, Walt Disney's original idea, and really turn it into something that's so successful and timeless like it is now.
You might want to be wary if you ever go to Disneyland Paris, Ruthie, because that one is a lot more like California Screamin', because not only do you get shot, you know, you go from 0 to 60 in 5 seconds because you get shot out of that cannon, similarly to how California Screamin' is, or I guess it's now the Incredicoaster, but
right.
but also it goes upside down.
Mm-hmm.
So just keep that in mind before you decide to go on the one in Paris. But I'm glad we had this opportunity to talk about Space Mountain. It's a classic attraction. One thing that whenever they start talking about redoing Tomorrowland, the first thing they ever say is, oh, but Space Mountain is staying. Like, it's a no-brainer. There's no way they would get rid of Space Mountain because, like Ruthie said earlier, it is timeless. there is nothing outdated about it at all. It doesn't get old. It doesn't seem like a dated version of what they used to think the future would be like. It just sort of holds its own over time. It still feels as futuristic today as it did in 1975. So that is our look at 45 years of intergalactic travel through a mountain in outer space. So I hope everybody enjoyed episode 118 of the Jiminy Crickets podcast. Ruthie, where can everybody find Jiminy Crickets on the web?
You can listen to all of our past shows, including audio versions of Dateline Jiminy Crickets, on our website, jcricketpodcast.blogspot.com. You can also listen to us on iTunes under the name Jiminy Crickets. That's with an exclamation point, and be sure to leave us a 5-star review. Over on our YouTube channel, we share updates to the DisneyChris website, including the Disneyland Magical Audio Tour, as well as past episodes of the Jiminy Crickets podcast and Dateline Jiminy Crickets. You can find our channel if you search for DisneyChris.com. And remember, .com is spelled out D-O-T-C-O-M. And don't forget to subscribe and click on the notification bell. You can also join in the conversation over on our Facebook page, Jiminy Crickets Podcast, where you can not only interact with Chris and me and all the fellow cricketeers, but you can also stay up to date on all the latest details of our many worldwide web endeavors. In addition to all the normal places you have always found our podcast, you can now also find us at the Roarbox, a unique website celebrating all aspects of geek culture, including Disney fandom. We are proud to be a part of this motley crew of pop culture superfans, and we share an episode of our podcast there each and every Thursday. So be sure to check out this amazing website at www.theroarbox.com. If you would like to contact the show with your questions or comments, our email address is DisneyChris, DOTCOM@gmail.com. We would love to hear from you.
We are now also on Instagram. Our official Instagram account is at DisneyChris_JC_podcast. There are already hundreds of colorful vintage Disney images on our page, and we are continually adding more fun Disney things to see. We're at 499 followers, so we just need one more to round it out. So if you haven't followed us yet, we'd love to reach 500. This is also a great place to get updates to our podcast and the Disney Chris website, so be sure to follow us on Instagram. You can find me on Twitter at DisneyChris73. And on Facebook, Ruthie can be found under the name Ruthie Brown, and I can be found under the name Chris Lyndon. That's spelled L-Y-N-D-O-N as in Lyndon Johnson. My website is DisneyChris.com, home to the Disney Song of the Day and the Disneyland Magical Audio Tour, where you'll find over 1,760 audio tracks from the happiest place on Earth. And I recently added about 100 new tracks. I've been very busy adding new content to the website, so if you haven't been there in a while, be sure to go and check out all the new stuff I've recently added. We would also like to give special thanks to those who help spread our magic with their generous support, and you can help support us at Dateline Jiminy Crickets, the Jiminy Crickets podcast, and the Disney Chris website by becoming a Patreon subscriber. And by joining our illustrious roster of supporters, you will receive exclusive rewards every month, including exclusive audio content, video commentaries, and an exclusive Patreon subscribers only podcast we like to call Down the Rabbit Hole. Additionally, your name will be featured on screen during the closing credits of each Dateline Jiminy Crickets podcast on YouTube. And be sure to check out our new donation levels and special rewards at www.patreon.com/DisneyChris. Alternatively, you can also make a one-time donation via PayPal. Recurring PayPal donators qualify for the same rewards as our Patreon subscribers. So you have the option to make a one-time or recurring donation via PayPal. You can do both over there. And you'll find links to all of these donation options at disneychris.com/donate.html. So do you have any final words for today, Ruthie?
I do. Here's to the future and you. Thanks for listening.
And always let your conscience be your guide.
When your heart is in your dream, no request is too